Topping the New York Times bestseller list.
The Shack is in the top 40 bestsellers of all history.
Having sold millions of copies since its release in 2007, the novel The Shack has become a publishing phenomenon. Now a feature film based on the influential book is to be released in March of 2017. What theology does the book teach? Should faithful Christians be concerned at its impact on the church? Documentary filmmaker Paul Flynn of Megiddo Films has released his latest work, The Shack, Its Dangerous Theology and Error, in an attempt to answer these questions. To watch this film free of charge, please visit our website at megiddofilms.org. That's megiddofilms.org.
You're listening to Megiddo Radio. Megiddo Radio is a radio ministry of Megiddo Media. For more, visit our website at megiddoradio.com. That's megiddoradio.com.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome. This is Paul Flynn with Megiddo Radio for the 23rd of February, 2017. Thank you all for tuning in. On tonight's show, we're going to be talking about Bill Johnson. Now, I promised to talk about Bill Johnson on last Monday's show, but I'm going to be talking about Bill Johnson today, and I'm going to try and take a break from talking about him for a while. I don't like covering the same issue too much, although I've only done a few shows on him recently. It just seems I've been covering him quite a bit. I'm not going to stop there. I have a number of his books in my library. Just looking over there, When Heaven Invades Earth, I've got a couple other books. And my hope and my prayer is, by the grace of God, and I pray that you keep this in prayer, that I'd have the time and the energy, etc. and so on, that I'll be talking, that I'll do a film, not just on Bill Johnson, but Bethel Church and everything else, and the massive influence that they're having. Now, this is what I thought about him. Was that he was the very, and the one reasons I covered him, there's a lot of heretics out there, but the one reasons I'm covering Bill Johnson is because he's very much the acceptable face still, to this day, he's very much the acceptable face of the charismatic movement, the really extreme, him and Michael Brown, but Michael Brown seems to be a genuine believer in the Lord, even though some massive discernment issues with Michael Brown, who had him on his radio program, but we've talked about that before, and we really don't need to repeat that again. But if you go back, if you type in Michael Brown into the search bar and we get a radio, you can listen to that show where I'm talking about that. But the difference with Michael Brown is he seems to be teaching, or Christian theology, the gospel, even though he's an Arminian, but the elements of the gospel that would be needed to believe are there. However, with Bill Johnson, it's another Christ, another gospel, because it's another Christ. And the gospel is, for them, signs, gifts, miracles, and wonders. Not, manifesting the kingdom through signs, gifts, and miracles, and wonders. And the way Bill Johnson will argue, and this is kind of similar to other false teachers, that they will kind of ebb and flow, and often it's cleverly sounding arguments without actually proving what they're talking about. It's called sophistry. I don't know if he's intentionally doing it. Only he could answer that, maybe, if he even knows he's doing that. But he kind of ebbs back and forth, and it doesn't really prove what he thinks it proves. And that is very characteristic of the whole book. It's like, how does that connect to this? Not that I don't understand what he's talking about, but there's no connection between the two. And they're cleverly sounding arguments, so that at the end of it, you're like going, no, I don't really understand this, but, you seem to know what you're talking about there, Bill Johnson. So The last show I did on Bill Johnson was very much a kind of, you could call it a review of God is Good. Because that book came out and he's promoting that. Bethel Church is promoting that. He's been on radio programs promoting that. And so let's see if it's a good Christian book. And I kind of gave a general overview of the major problems with that. So go back to show number 242, I think it is. But again, why am I going back to him again? Because, you know, sometimes with some shows, maybe like I've done two on Joel Osteen's a lot more obvious. But he's not respected in conservative circles. Whereas, again, Bill Johnson, in a number of circles, Nabil Qureshi, that whole influence of Ravi Zacharias, and Ravi Zacharias would go anywhere, even go to Ligonier Ministries. It's amazing. You've got Ligonier Ministries that has Ravi Zacharias on preaching for them. It was recently enough. Look, and I'm not talking about secondary separation here, but there's some serious issues with Ravi Zacharias' ministry as well. And pulling away from Ravi Zacharias would not be based on you hang out with so-and-so. I'm not talking about secondary separation here. I'm talking about him as a person is doing things that are not biblical and are dangerous. And his organization is involved in stuff like that. And Nabil Qureshi now teaches, and I had the video there, I don't know, was it a month or two ago, of how he believes Christians can and should today raise the dead. You heard me right. That's Nabil Qureshi. I've already covered in the show before. But a lot of this is Bethel Church's region. This, what I believed about Bill Johnson being an acceptable face, is very much backed up by Andrew Strom, who is according to his own biography, a revival preacher and author from New Zealand. He's a founder of John the Baptist TV, etc. He's a charismatic still. He came out of this NAR prophetic movement, whatever you want to call it, and he's very much against it. Now, the problem with his book is his arguments are very subjective, very much experience-based. This person said this, that's a bit weird. He'll talk against Benny Johnson, the wife of Bill Johnson, waking up angels in the desert and all this kind of weird stuff. We don't even have time to get into all this. Seriously. Honestly. I mean, Benny Johnson's views are so New Age, it is out of whack, but we're not even going to get into that today. Not today. Just don't have time. Lord willing, I'm going to put it in a movie. I don't want it to be a whole smorgasbord of everything that's wrong, because I want to keep it to stuff that's connected. But Andrew Strom, who defected, and a lot of charismatics don't seem to like him anymore from the movement, because it's damaging for their PR. But he's his own theology is not fantastic, but he wrote a book called Kundalini Warning, and some of the book is right on the money. He said, while warning of the more openly, quote, extreme, unquote, types of ministries, it is also important to remember that there are others who represent a more, quote, acceptable face, unquote, to this movement. Bill Johnson is the pastor of Bethel Church in Redding, California, a hugely influential fellowship in the charismatic movement. Bill is the author of the book When Heaven Invades Earth, and says many good things. And this is, I don't think it says many good things, but anyway. Especially about healing and ministry in the streets, etc. So, look, if you do read Andrew Strom's book, he's heavily charismatic, and he uses language like the charismatics are spirit-filled. Critics like John MacArthur are, it seems by deduction, by implication, or not. If he doesn't mean to say that, he needs to reword it. Sadly, and I don't like boasting like that, spirit-filled. But anyway, sadly, behind the scenes, Bethel, especially their school of ministry, is literally loaded with Toronto-type flakiness, spiritual drunkenness, and so on. And I maybe That's why they don't want any critics getting inside. I played the clip there, when was it? Monday of last week, where Tony Miano, who's a open critic of the of Bethel Church, was stopped from attending. And I talked about that in the previous show, if you want to listen to that. Trying to find... So anyway, he's kind of the acceptable face of the movement, and that's really what I want to tackle. And today, on today's show, I really wanted to focus on the last aspect that I'm going to look at before I kind of... Unless something major happens in the news. Now, also, there's been... Look, there's been so many things, and I haven't been able to keep up with it. Nor should I probably try to. There was also a thing a couple of weeks ago where Bill Johnson praised, and this is really birds of a feather flock together, praised Benny Hinn. I think, I don't know if, I can't remember, it was on Facebook, brother-in-law sent it to me. I think Benny Hinn might have spoken at Bethel. Could be wrong about that, but anyway, there was a big praise. So Bill Johnson thinks a lot of Benny Hinn, you know, birds of a feather. There was comments at the bottom about Benny Hinn being an obvious charlatan. But Bill Johnson and Michael Brown don't seem to see that. Anyway, but am I shocked? Am I surprised? Is it newsworthy? Not really. I mean, two heretics meeting together. But look, why am I doing this? Gotta go. If they're just out and out heretics, surely everybody in their church is deceived and on the way to hell. Look, I pray by the grace of God that those people might be lost, believing in the teaching of Bethel, and I pray that you'll come to know Christ. That's one thing I hope for. That people will come to know Christ, that you will repent of your folly and need. Signs, gifts, miracles, and wonder stuff that was only for new revelation of God, that you will believe in sola scriptura, that the word of God is the final, complete word of God. That's the first thing. I pray that for those, I don't know how many, I believe there are true believers in there. Maybe new converts, maybe naive, maybe not sure about certain things, maybe scratching their head, like, what are they doing with the gold dust, and what's with the feathers, and all this kind of weird stuff, and why are they acting drunk? I don't participate, but I don't want to criticize. I don't completely understand it. You know, you could be a new believer, maybe a couple of years saved or something like that, and you just don't know. And I implore you, I entreat you, come out from among them and be ye separate. And go to a faithful church of Jesus Christ. And also to warn for those who might, you know, promote the book or share the book or read the book and think that it's okay, maybe based on something, excuse me, that Michael Brown said on his radio program, The Line of Fire, or somebody else, because he's seen as the acceptable face, and that's why I felt the need, because there's very little criticism of Bethel in legitimate, good, well-packaged, you could say, critiques. There just isn't. I don't see many of them. Now, I'm not saying that there aren't. Again, I bring up Tony Miano. He's the only person I could really find. I don't like ministries that kind of start saying, oh, we're the only people covering this issue. It's not probably not true, but I just didn't see much else around. And I think I've done searches on Sermon Audio. And look, there are videos, just to clarify as well, there are videos on YouTube, but they're just, and they're very good videos, by the way. Anybody's put them together, great. I'm not knocking it or anything like that, but it's just kind of, it's just clips stuck together. It's not really a critique of the view and explaining to somebody who might agree with Bill Johnson or be bamboozled with some of Bill Johnson's art why exactly it is wrong. So that's what I'm saying. That's where the lack is. There are videos of his heretical teachings we put together, but here's the thing. People in Bethel Church, they follow him, and they don't think it's heretical. And if they do think it's false, they don't seem to think it's that big of a deal. Word of Faith theology. Hard to nail down because there's variations within the movement, as there are with a lot of false teachings and different movements. Very similar to Law of Attraction, kind of like stuff that Joel Osteen teaches, is taught by Bill Johnson. And I think it's incredibly serious, heretical, satanic. I have called Joel Osteen's theology in the past satanic. And I use strong language like that because you look at Joel Osteen and his smiley face, he seems like a really nice guy. However, he's teaching satanic theology, and it doesn't matter how pleasant he may be. Bill Johnson seems very nicely spoken, whatever, I don't know. But what he's teaching here is satanic. On page 164 of God is Good, and we're going back to a little bit of what we covered the last time. The Apostle Paul, it says in 164, taught us to prophesy according to our faith. And he links to Romans 12:6. And just to clarify, prophesy there according to our faith. Let's go to Romans 12:6. Look, let's get context here, because don't just accept on the face of it. Read the passages and say, is this actually what it's talking about? Check out commentaries as well. Not that the commentaries will always be right, but having the gifts differing according to the grace that's given to us, whether prophesy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. And prophesy can mean worship. It's used like that when it talks about head coverings in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. So, and also with Saul, with David, and things like that. So, it's not talking about vision, this is not talking about vision casting necessarily, but, okay, this is amazing, he says, Bill Johnson. Faith has an effect on what we prophesy. This explains many of the words of judgment that continually flow from some of our leaders. Now, you read this and you kind of go, okay, what's he talking about? But he's saying some of our leaders prophesy judgment. They bring bad things because they say the wrong thing. It's the law of attraction. But it repackaged in a very Christian way. Seriously, this is what it is. At the end of the program, I'm going to give you all the page references. If you have the book at home and you don't believe me and you just say, no, this is not what it's teaching, I'll give you the page references, but I'm on page 164. Not going to be able to quote everything, but I'll try and quote everything for context and try and explain exactly what he's teaching. So it is easier to prophesy judgment than reformation when our confidence is in the power of sin and its effects instead of the power of the gospel. So he's saying if you believe, you'll prophesy, say forth words, what's been wrong before, judgment has flowed from our leaders, apparently. Society naturally declines in the absence of great outpouring of the Spirit. Comment on that. It's all in our hands. This is the teaching of Bill Johnson. We activate it. God's basically waiting for us to do it. It's not that he says, and then he clarifies in other places, not that God can't, but he's given away some of his power. You see, the seriousness of that is, and it talks about free will and all this kind of stuff, that is saying that God has ceased control by his own choice. That means God has ceased to be God in this area. God cannot cease to be God. We can't be in control in the way that Bill Johnson says, otherwise we would die. Do you understand that? Without God, we can't breathe. We would not have anything. It is an impossibility, what he describes in his view of sovereignty. It is impossible and heretical. And if our prophets, who both, quote, foretell and cause, very similar to Joel Osteen, by the way, forsake the responsibility to declare the purposes of God with their words, then what are we to expect? So, saying, okay, you're not saying forth, you know, the promises of God, you don't say forth the things, then well, what do you expect? Bad things are going to happen. That's kind of what he's saying. And going on to quote from Bill Johnson, in part, the prophetic ministry causes, quote unquote, change by declaring such change. Listen to that. The prophetic ministry causes change by declaring such change. You declare good things happen. You declare bad things happen. That's the law of attraction. It's a cult. It's Madame Helena Petrovna Blavatsky of the Theosophical Society. It is not biblical Christianity. It is New Age. Bill Johnson knows it. It is New Age. And his explanation for that in another book, I can't remember the exact book, but if anybody wants to email me, amigdofilms@gmail.com for the reference. I've talked about it before. Yeah, I know it's, I'm paraphrasing now, but yeah, I know it's from the New Age, but that's because they stole it from us. That's his explanation. So we have to declare it accordingly. That is, and he twists the verse, Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. It's basically saying man is a little God and he's in control. And the same way God spoke, the universe is in control by his words and declarations, so are we. He doesn't say we're little gods, but that's where it comes from. It's the lie from the devil in the Garden of Eden. You should be like gods, knowing good and evil. He says in the next, just skipping ahead a little bit, on page 165, some things actually come about because of the faith of those. Now listen to this. Some of these things actually come about because of the faith of those who have gained a place of authority to declare. It's because of them. Not because God is sovereign or anything. Both Abraham and Moses illustrate this truth beautifully. They shape the course of history through their friendships with God. Those who simply identify the errors of the day do little more for us than do our newspapers and TV newscasters. Well, you must have a huge problem with someone like Jeremiah and Isaiah. According to this understanding, well, you know, why did it happen? Why did judgment come upon Israel? It was because of Jeremiah. The life in the pit of hell. It's a life in the pit of hell. I pray to God that you can see this. He's saying we need to declare that the words you prophesy, if he's coded in scriptural language, he's a fifth generational pastor, he knows how to talk like a Christian. But in a much better way than Joel Osteen ever could. But it's essentially the same thing. Slight variations on it, of course. But he's saying things actually happened because people declared it and it came about. On the end of page 165, he says, talks about, I am not impressed with those who tell me they watched the buildings on 9/11 and knew in their hearts that such calamity would not bring revival to America. Is that prophetic insight? He's saying that this causes it. He's saying they're linked. Or have we become so impressed with darkness that we contribute to the problem with our declarations, prayers, and negative responses? Now he drifts away again from it. On page 171 and page 172, he returns to the idea. And for the sake of time, I can't go through every single part of the page. But he says on page 172, correct words. He also said correct words, the right declarations. Correct words attract heaven and infuriate the powers of darkness. While the powers of darkness are not to be the focus of our message, their influence must be confronted and threatened by our declarations. Not we're praying to God to lead us in wisdom and truth. That we flee from the devil, or, you know, not flee from the devil, but flee from errors and submit to God, that the devil will flee from us and things like that. and die to ourselves daily. No, we declare this. Again, it's little God's theology. That we are in control. God is delegating control to us. This is the heretical teaching of Bill Johnson. He's saying, you say the right thing, it will happen. Now, he might deviate from that at times. He might be inconsistent, but that's essentially what he teaches. It says in page 172, may the Lord give us a word that confronts. Again, it's talk about extra revelation. We talked about that before. He talks about increasing revelation. He says, oh, yeah, I appreciate scripture, but, you know, he's saying, okay, the written scripture is done, but we've got extra revelation. Again, his language is very veiled, but we talked about that in a previous show. It was on show number 240, I think it was 243, but it was Monday of last week, anyway, whatever number that was. So he says, may the Lord give us a word that confronts the powers of darkness, releases heaven and earth, and launches us. And like apparently, according to Bill Johnson, this will cause it. Not that we pray and ask petition that God will do this. No, no. We by using the right words, will activate this. This is kind of what it is. But God then is dependent upon us. We become sovereign and God isn't. There's no such thing as a shared sovereignty. Someone is sovereign, someone is in control. Bill Johnson says, I think it's on page, oh, maybe it's 152 or around there anyway, that God is in charge. Not in control. That's a pretty much almost a direct quote. That's heresy. This man is a heretic. And if any man teaches any other gospel, let him be anathema. Says it releases heaven and earth and launches us into our God-given destiny. It's all about us. That is what God will say, quote, amen to. So it's just really, God becomes our bellboy, and it's disgusting. It's absolutely disgusting. But for the sake of time, we're going to have to skip ahead really fast. Page 174 talks more about, again, he doesn't keep going with it. I don't know if he intentionally does this, but anyway. At the end of page 174, it says, many prophetic words come out of human reasoning. Society always declines in the absence of revival, and the declining moral condition of the world always ends in judgment if there is no move of God. That sentence makes no sense. Judgment is a move of God. God brings the judgment. God also brings the blessings, but I digress. Prophetic judgments, he says, are an easy mathematical calculation. Increasing sin without repentance equals judgment. That is why we are to prophesy according to faith, not human reasoning. For then we prophesy, not according to what we see in the natural, but what we see in the spirit through faith. Note that it's the prophetic word itself that helps to bring about the change desired. That last sentence just proves again that he's word of faith. Note that it's the prophetic word itself. And he says, like God, give us a prophetic word. I think that's on page 172. Confront darkness and all this kind of thing. But he says, it's the prophetic word itself that helps to bring about the change desired. Again, it's repackaged, occult teaching, law of attraction. Your words shape your reality around you and things like that. And he says, but this is why we are to prophesy according to faith. See, faith is kind of seen as kind of a blind, mystical thing. Not according to human reasoning. Now, we're supposed to come, let us reason together, saith the Lord. I think it's Isaiah 1:18, if I'm not mistaken. we're supposed to think. Even the word metanoia, repentance in the Bible, to turn, means literally meta, change, noia, mind, to change the way we think. Now, it's not just a mere belief in the facts of the gospel, but it's a fundamental change of our core of our being, because we're regenerated, we are changed from darkness into light, from loving darkness into loving the truth. Same thing said again and again, but he's very veiled about it, I'll be honest. 176. Our present chaos results in part from the errors of that era, that there was no hope in the future. And whatever hope for the future is absent, there's always a lack of prophecies that come from faith. So he says, dark future, lack of prophecies. True prophetic decrees, he says, are catalytic. They must be spoken to bring about the change they speak of. So it's all dependent on, again, it's, you're a little God. This is, again, what it's teaching. Now, he doesn't say it in so many words, and he also diminishes Christ when he says, on page 51, when Christ is upon earth, he's, you know, he says he emptied himself of the rights of, as God. He empties himself of his rights as God, and took upon himself the limitation of man. Now, he does say in the next line, while Jesus never stopped being God, he has to put in that for controversy's sake and all that kind of thing. But can you be still God? And it's like saying you're a citizen of the United States or Ireland, but you don't have the rights of a U.S. citizen or an Irish citizen. Are you really a U.S. citizen? Okay, a lot of people listening to this are probably from the United States. Imagine if, are you really a U.S. citizen if none of the Bill of Rights, the Constitution, does not apply to you? You have no rights as a citizen. Are you a citizen? Or is somebody speaking out both sides of their mouth? I'll let you decide. And if you have the book yourself, this heretical teaching is also taught in page 169 and 170. Well, kenosis theory. Jesus was always God. Bill Johnson's idea is he became a mere man. Whatever he wants to say, it's just the way he tries to cover himself, so that we can do exactly what Jesus did. Otherwise, we'd never be able to follow that. It'd be impossible. They're pretty much his own words. We go to page 169, 170. He says, let's face it, if Jesus did all his miracles as God, I'm still impressed. But that is an impossible example for me to follow. So that's the problem he has with it. I can't do that. Yeah, you can't, because you're not Jesus. Jesus, a man of God, approved. I'll just get the scripture verse in front of me, Acts chapter 2. And I quote this verse a lot, but it's a very important verse. He says, Jesus of Nazareth, verse 22 of Acts 2, a man approved of God among you by miracles, wonders, and signs. Well, he's approved among you by miracles, wonders, and signs. But what if everybody can do that? Oh, does that mean there's more than one begotten God, Son of God? Now, Bill Johnson doesn't say that. I was talking about Paula White there a few weeks ago. Paula White does teach that Jesus Christ is not, I repeat, not the only begotten Son of God. He's one of many. He's the first fruits, but he says there's many other begotten. So that's a huge problem for something like the Trinity. If the authenticating signs, miracles, and wonders are not different for Christ, showing that he is not like the apostles, he is the Son of God, he is unique. Yes, the apostles do carry out miracles, signs, and wonders, but they're not exactly the same. The miracles, signs, and wonders by Elijah are not exactly the same. But all these point towards the fact that he's the Messiah, the Son of God. rising from the dead by your own power is not normal, and it's something that Bill Johnson even said. Problem with going through a book like this is it's so bad. I can't, in an hour show, cover it all. You kind of, and I'm not even saying that people need to do this, you kind of have to read it. And it doesn't get especially bad until about a page 150 onwards. The whole premise of the whole book, God is Good, is that God's amazing. God's good. He's fantastic. Here's my teaching, sprinkled on top of it. Kind of like, if you believe God is good, signs, miracles, and wonders are for today. You can do exactly what he did. God is good. That's all it is. That's the whole, most of the arguments. God is amazing. God is wonderful. Yeah, and every Christian or professing Christian will say, at least for their imagination of God or whatever they, if it's the true God or somebody who thinks they're Christian or whatever, will always say God is good, of course. So, oh, well, we've got everybody saying God is good. Oh, okay, God is good. You'll believe this. It says on page 169 again, Jesus did nothing as God. He chose to live with the restrictions of a man. He did nothing as God. So there was nothing unique about his miracles, signs, and wonders. He did it as a man, and any man can follow him. What blasphemy. We can follow him in his communicable attributes. We can't follow him perfectly because of our sin nature. Even in a regenerate state, we still have the old man. You read Romans chapter 7. He is the eternal Son of God, he talks. He chose to live with the limitations of a man so that he might give us something to follow. He's giving us an example to follow. Wow, that just sounds like 19th century liberalism. But anyway. There's other implications and there's other serious problems. I mean, utterly serious problems with his theology. And I have to read his other books to see. But there's other serious heresies just to make sure, because I don't want to say he's teaching something that he's not. Talks about we'll leave it for another time. Okay, so let's continue with this. So page 176. So he's saying, okay, the hope for the future is gone because we're not prophesying. He says, true prophetic decrees are catalytic. They must be spoken to bring about the change they speak of. Tragically, if this is during that time that abortion became legalized, is this not a natural byproduct of not having a word of faith for tomorrow? Why did abortion get... Okay, abortion was brought in because of the hardness of the heart. The hardness of the heart of those in Roe versus Wade, in the turning of the United States of America further and further away from God. And in not seeking God's face, not really honoring God. But he's saying, no, no, no. It's because the church isn't saying the correct words and it's being too negative. Law of attraction. You say, you speak positive things. This is what the occult believe. This is what I don't like this guy or anything like that, but the Irish MMA fighter, don't recommend anybody watch MMA, by the way. Just people beating the heads off each other. I can see the skill and all this. People are going to be talking about the skill, but it's really violent, and our society's violent enough, and especially horrible when women are involved in it, but I digress. But even Conor McGregor, who's an Irish MMA fighter, he believes in this stuff. This is an occult theology coming from The Secret. You speak, this is why he's so boastful and all this. He said, you speak all these things, you be grateful, you You speak things into existence and good things are attracted towards you. You, by your words and your thoughts, arrange and you know, like attracts like, positive attracts positive. Steve Harvey teaches this as well, kind of a prosperity gospel type. He's not an evangelist, but he's a TV personality, comedian. I'm trying to think who else. Joel Osteen teaches it. The New Thought Movement, Helena Petrova Blavatsky taught it. And she believed that Lucifer was God. He was the light bearer, the true bearer of light. That's in Isis volume, Isis Unveiled volume 2. That's where this thing comes from. I'm not saying that Bill Johnson read Helena Petrova Blavatsky and then said, oh yeah, that's a good, no, I don't know where he got it from. The teaching's been around since the serpent in the Garden of Eden. Man believing that he was more than he was. Believing the lie of the serpent that God is keeping something back from you and there's not a good reason to obey him. Obey him because he's God. But the serpent was, you shan't surely die. God doth know in the day ye eat thereof, ye shall know good and evil. God is holding secret knowledge back from you. That's the lie. Here's secret knowledge that we're in control. You will be like God. And what did God do? He spoke the universe into existence. He is in complete control. He has decreed whatsoever cometh to pass. That's what the Westminster Confession of Faith and other Orthodox confessions of faith in the Christian Church have affirmed. It says in the same page, 176, is this not to be an action born out of conviction that righteousness is more powerful than sinfulness? Is this not the attitude that positions us to become the agents of change instead of people who want to escape? Now, yes, we shouldn't be, often these people set up the legitimate criticism of dispensationalism and, man, we just want to get out of here and stuff like that. I don't agree with that at all, by the way. I believe, by the way, for anybody who's listening and might agree with Bill John, I believe that there is a revival in the future. I believe, I'm post-millennial, I believe that the nations of the earth will be brought into covenant relationship with God. Mass multitudes will be brought in and be saved by the gospel of Jesus Christ in the future. We don't know when that is. It could be 100 years' time. It could be tomorrow. I don't know. But that is in, and that's the view, not modern postmillennialism, in case anybody's studying this, but Puritan postmillennialism of would be similar to John Owen. John Owen's view would be similar to my view. Actually, and to be honest, the Puritans held a very, very similar view. There were some people that had different views and different things. But right up to B.B. Warfield, even. For a long time, I thought he was all-mill. Then I saw a few quotes from him that made him really look like he was post-millennial. I believe that the gospel isn't finished and we're just going to get worse and worse. The gospel is going to go forth, and just as a mustard seed will spread, grow, start off small and grow, as leaven will be, as the kingdom of God is like unto leaven, and the whole lump is leavened. The rock cut without hands in Daniel's image will smite the image. That is the Babylonian Empire. The Roman Antichrist will be destroyed. Islam will be destroyed, secularism, all these kind of world systems that rise against the God of glory will be destroyed in the future by the preaching of the gospel, not by political means, by the preaching of the gospel, and by the sovereign saving grace of Jesus Christ and being applied by the Holy Spirit, effectually calling multitudes into the kingdom, starting with Israel. and then other nations will follow. Following on with Romans 11:26. All Israel shall be saved. Now, there's people of different views on that, but I would form very, very much in line with trying to think somebody I would agree with, say Charles Hodge, 19th century Princeton theologian. Read his commentary on Romans 11, and that's pretty much my view. But so, yeah, I believe that the best is yet... There isn't just pessimistic premillennial dispensationalism or what the charismatic movement through Bill Johnson is. There are other views that have been espoused by the church that are based off of how will this come about, the preaching of the gospel. And that we will pray, not that it will cause it, but we ask God that he would be merciful to sinners. That's the difference. Not that we're declaring, saying the right words, say the correct words, and this will happen. That's the occult. Okay, so the next quotation is on page 183 of this book. He says, trying to get the, oh yeah, here we go. I have so much of this page highlighted, but it's not all the same heresy, so I'm trying to keep it to the same heresy, the same teaching. Oh boy. He says on page 183, in the middle of the page, having the right message in the right hour releases an unparalleled realm of supernatural activity. The right message, right words will release things. You do this, this happens. You're the agent of change. You're in control. Not Christian at all. Page 197. Again, I'm giving you all the references. If you do not believe me, if you might have listened to a few of Bill Johnson's teachings and you might think he's very good or whatever, and you don't believe me, and you might think I'm lying or whatever, here are the page references in this book. And if you don't have a problem, once you've studied through and rethought through what's being said here, and you don't have a problem with what's been said, I fear for your soul. 197. Talks about John the Baptist. He said, one day while John was baptizing people in the river, he noticed a man in the distance. He pointed to him saying, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, unquote. This is in John 1:29. John had prophesied of his coming, but he is present. And then he talks about what it was his role to be a voice in the wilderness. That was his role. That was what he was supposed to do. Now, there's so many problems here. I don't want to get distracted here, but 212. Thinking about that, right? He says that John the Baptist's role was to prophesy. This is how things come about. Releasing the right words at the right time brings about supernatural release of energy and all this kind of idea. Then he says this. Now, this is not about John the Baptist, but I'm just showing how this will unravel the entire scriptures, if believed in any way consistently. He says, so many of the breakthroughs in scripture would not have happened if the people of God didn't declare what God told them to declare. Jesus told us, and he gives a quote from Mark 11:26. He says, they would not have happened. So, Jesus' coming was... Is Jesus' coming? Bill Johnson, I'm going to ask you in the off on the odd chance that you might listen to this. Did Jesus coming depend upon what John declared? Was it dependent on that? Or is God in complete control of all things, even the will of man? We don't completely understand the sovereignty of God. Of course we don't. We're not God. But God is the first cause of all things. He decreed whatsoever to come to pass. And it's by his fore... It says in... Acts 2. Even with the cross of Christ, and nothing was left up to chance and say, it depended on him, and if he didn't say this, this couldn't happen. That is a serious heresy. It says... Him, and this is in reference to the cross of Christ and the cross of Christ and the crucifixion in Acts 2:23, him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God, ye have taken by wicked hands, have crucified and slain. Just going to read this part again. Him being delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. How was he delivered? By the foreknowledge of God and determinate counsel of God. Nothing was left to chance. Nothing was dependent upon finite creatures and the decisions that they made. Yes, they did so freely, this free agency. John the Baptist decreed that he was regenerated in the womb. We know this from Luke chapter 1. And he was prepared for that by the Spirit of God. Nothing. We are not the cause. We're not the... God uses secondary agents. Yes. Means of reaching people. But it doesn't depend on them. Page 199. I think pretty much finished on that teaching. But give you one or two more seriously disturbing quotes. He is all powerful. What he doesn't control. Notice what he says. What he doesn't control. What do you mean what he doesn't control? He's all powerful, but he doesn't control something. How is that all powerful exactly? What he doesn't control is our response to him. That's not all powerful. That's somewhat powerful, but that's not all powerful. He has influence, but not control. That's what Bill Johnson says. As he's given us a more valuable gift, a free will. And this shows the danger of Arminianism. Now, I'm not saying that every Arminian will agree with him. A lot of would disagree with him. But it does open up to man is in control of his salvation. What else is he in control of? Yeah. And page 210. I'm giving a lot of quotes here. But talks about reigning in life. And, you know, different, prophet, priests, and kings. That is true. Then he says, reigning in life means, this is on page 210, reigning in life means that I am not controlled by the fear of man, but instead I live in the fear of God. That's true. Yeah, we should do that. Circumstances don't run my life. That should be true, too. You know, the storms come, and we should firmly fix our eyes upon Christ, and whatever happens. But then he says this, I reign over circumstances. I reign. Not God reigns. I reign. Reigning in life means I live with the tools to have a healthy family. Well, a lot of people will say, look, he says, it talks about the glory of God and this theology is a departure from the truth. Christians have, for centuries, spoken out against errors in the church, such as the Pentecostal charismatic movement. If you're a Pentecostal charismatic in the charismatic movement, you are believing in heresies that have been condemned by the church for centuries. Going right back to Chrysostom, Augustine, Eusebius, when he was writing about Montanus in the second century, he talked about Montanus being possessed by a spirit, which is kind of second century Pentecostal movement style nonsense. And what ultimately it's saying is these powers are in our control, not God's. Now they'll say they play lip service to God, but so does everybody, so does Rick Warren. Apparently God has delegated these powers. Powers which are not delegatable. These are powers which only God possesses. Being in all control of all things. That's what it means to be all powerful. The way Bill Johnson argues, and he says, well, God is all powerful, but he's not in control of everything. Or words to that effect. It's like saying, not exactly saying, but just like an analogy saying, well, here's a man, and he's pregnant. They don't go together. A man can't get pregnant. Although if you sadly listen to some people in who've been indoctrinated with gender studies issues, but anybody else who has stuck with centuries of understanding on these issues. But anyway, two statements that contradict each other completely. Does this sound like a Christian man to you? Someone who will say this. And I'm probably not going to be talking about this. I pray I won't be talking about this topic. I will come back to it, Lord willing. Maybe, probably in the radio show. A man who believes that God, quote, has desires that may or may not be fulfilled. Because God has the power, but he's just given it away. That's, he had the power, and then he gave it away. Which basically translates into this. God wants to not be in control. God wants you to be God by trusting in him, and he wants you in control. This is what it translates into. He could have the power, he manages things, but he's given you the power to become gods. Does that sound like the God of the Bible? Or does that sound like the serpent in the Garden of Eden? This has been Paul Flynn. May God bless you all.